Everyone, it's Jamal Thomas. Welcome to the Progressive Soapbox. Rachel Maddow again. I explained it before. Why is a lefty hitting a lefty? If you're going to do a show, let me explain it this way. My objectives for this channel are twofold. One is to be as honest as I possibly can be, to function with a particular level of integrity in presenting a story, giving context to the story, and being honest about how I regard the story. Earnestness is important to me. The other part of that is, if we're ever going to get past the partisanship, like if we're ever going to get to a point where people are having substantive conversations about actual policy, they're having, even if they necessarily disagree, they're not necessarily being disagreeable within that disagreement, that they can work towards good ends, even if I'm not going to agree with you on everything, or vice versa, to be able to agree to the degree that we actually agree, meaning we're not reflexively going against somebody. We're not reflexively saying, well, that person is being partisan, so I can just discount everything that person says. That's a problem. Even if the information that they're giving is correct, just because the information they're giving correct does not mean they're giving you the right impression. You can be absolutely correct in what you're saying and given an impression that's completely wrong and completely backwards and completely duplicitous. The contention that I make here, and the contention that I make in my other videos and what Rachel Maddow does, is it's the latter. She's completely duplicitous in how she gets across information. Yes, the information that she's relaying may or may not be true. Sometimes, most of the times, I would say it's true. But what is she trying to give you with that information? Like when she's exposing a story to you, when she's saying, this is what took place, here's the context of what took place, what you leave with is just as important as what she told you about. Meaning that you're leaving with things that she never directly told you, per se. What I mean is, if you and I are having a conversation, every conversation we have, I'm talking about how horrible Republicans are. If you know that I'm a Democrat, and you know that I'm essentially boosting up certain people, so I think Hillary is awesome, Obama is awesome, Gabbard is awesome, you know, Warren is awesome. Right off the bat, it's baked into the cake for the most part that I'm saying these other guys are the problem and these guys who I think are awesome and who these guys who I essentially blow up are the good guys. She is making a very clear demarcation point between they're the problem, these guys are the solution. The problem is the Democratic Party is not the solution. It's not the solution. And she's functioning as a shill for that party. She's being completely dishonest in regards to this thing about Russia. Rachel Maddow doesn't know what the hell is going on with Russia. Nobody does. And it's completely disingenuous to get on her show night after night after night and pretend that Russia is trying to attack the country or that Donald Trump is some kind of foreign agent of Russia. She doesn't necessarily reveal that Clinton and that many of the Democrats also had those ties with Russia, that the Podesta group had ties with Russia, that the Uranium One deal, where they gave all that uranium to Russia, some kind of business deal. The country that she's red-baiting, the country that she says is trying to take over the United States or whatever. Implicit. She didn't necessarily say that. I'm being implicit just in the tenor of her show. Why are we giving her uranium if it's that much of a threat? Why is Clinton interacting with these guys? Why is the Democratic Party interacting with these guys? And why is it okay for the Democratic Party to interact with them? But the moment that Trump makes some kind of friendly, conciliatory opening, all of a sudden he's a Russian agent that's trying to subvert the U.S. government. I would agree with you that to some degree he's subverting the U.S. government. I do not agree that he's a Russian agent. You have no proof whatsoever to make these accusations. Let's look at it. And there's two videos for this because I kind of want to get across exactly what I'm talking about and when I'm making this point that she's not giving you context, even though she's giving you the appearance of context. This conversation she's having about Trump, essentially a business deal in, I think it's called Azerbaijan, and she's making this case saying, look, there's something squirrely about a business deal that took place in that particular country that Trump was affiliated with, and she's pretty overtly making an argument that what Trump was doing was to some degree illegal because he was essentially bribing a particular person. She's making this case of corruption. But let's take a look for a second.
That is, in fact, a lovely view there, right next to the Caspian Sea. That's nowhere near the building she's there to work on. That's not where the Trump Tower was going. We think she's at the Four Seasons, which is 5 kilometers away and an hour's walk away from where the Trump building was going up in the middle of town, nowhere near the sea, right? In all its hard-to-look-at glory. This building in this random neighborhood in Baku, Azerbaijan, it's a building, it's a business project that really just doesn't make sense on the surface. Building's a huge luxury development in a city that isn't sustaining its current luxury properties. It's in the wrong part of town for a luxury property. No way was ever designed to get into the property. Why was this built? How could it ever make financial sense to pour this much in terms of resources into something that doesn't even seem like it was designed to work?
Look, as somebody who talks fast, I can appreciate that. Look, I used to like her show. I used to like her analysis, and I used to like the speed at which she would relay information. I don't know if it's that way for her, but for me, I get a huge amount of information at once. Trying to get the information out, it comes out pretty fast. So I can appreciate it. The thing that's interesting here is she has a lot of questions, if you notice. I mean, she's talking about this property, and she's saying, look, it's a... you know, somewhat of a dilapidated property, it's run down, why is this particular business deal taking place? Why are they doing this business deal in an area that can support other luxury business deals? The questions are perfectly fine. The questions are actually quite good. Let's keep moving.
This was supposed to be Trump Tower, Baku, Azerbaijan. 1 month after our presidential election, the Trump Organization abandoned this project. They pulled out. And here's what you need to know. The Trump family's business partner in that project was the family of the transportation minister. Azerbaijan, the one who made all those lucrative partnerships, the inexplicably lucrative deals with companies that really do appear to just be fronts for the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. Apparently helping the Iranian Revolutionary Guard launder money, evade sanctions for their support of terrorism around the world, and making himself and his own family wildly wealthy in the process.
All right, so just to be clear, it's not just Russia. Trump is not just a Russian spy. He's also apparently working with Iran. And working with Iran to spread terrorism around the world by dealing with some kind of money dealings that's behaving as kind of a slush fund or as a money laundering agent. Mind you, Trump is actively trying to attack Iran, but whatever. Let's see.
That was their partner. His family was their partner in that deal. Deals that make no financial sense on the surface are worth a second look to see if they make some other kind of sense, some other way of looking at it. If you are a government official who gets rich off the contracts you award and the projects you greenlight, you might award anything as a contract, right? You might greenlight anything. And American businesses are free to do business anywhere it is legal to do business in the world. But American businesses are not allowed to accept any funds if the origin of those funds is a sanctioned organization like the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. And you have to check it out. You have to know. American businesses are not allowed to participate in business deals with partners who are acting illegally. And you have to know. You have to check it out. Looking the other way is not a defense. Do you know the handbag company Dooney and Burke? Me neither. I don't even know if I'm saying it right. But they're very nice handbags. And I'm learning about them now because Frederick Burke of Dooney and Burke was convicted in 2009 of doing a business deal in Azerbaijan with a corrupt partner. The handbag guy wasn't paying the bribes. He was just in business with an Azerbaijani guy who did pay bribes, who was corrupt. And that's enough to put the handbag guy in federal prison. If you're an American business, you are expected to do your due diligence to make sure the people you're doing business with are not paying bribes. They're not corrupt. In the case of this inexplicable Trump building project that was inexplicably abandoned right after the election, Trump and his family were in the business... we're in business with the cartoon caricature of corruption in that country. And I mean that almost literally. In the fall of 2014, 4 months before Ivanka Trump was on the balcony of the Four Seasons showing off the Caspian Sea from a normal hotel location, you know, the family she was there to do business with was featured in this article in Foreign Policy magazine. Look at the headline. The Corleones of the Caspian. Under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which is U.S. law, not to put too fine a point on it, but under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, you cannot go into business with the Corleones of the Caspian. You must, as an American business, do due diligence to make sure your financial partners in your international businesses are not paying bribes, are not outrageously corrupt, are not involved in huge repeated financial dealings with sanctioned international sponsors of terrorism like the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. It is a violation of U.S. law to do business with, to make money from, a business partnership like that. The new president, as I said, he and his organization backed out of this deal a month after the election. Not before he received millions of dollars in the deal. We know that from the limited financial filing he made as a candidate for president. If there is going to be an independent investigation of this president and his campaign and his ties to Russia, right? It is inconceivable that an independent investigation would not include an examination of the president's financials, right? His tax returns, his business records, all the rest. Adam Davidson at The New Yorker has just detailed enough about the president's dealings in this one former Soviet republic to raise several questions. Is the president or his family potentially at risk of having violated the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, which is a crime for which you go to jail? Is the president or is his family potentially at risk of being blackmailed by foreign business partners who have evidence of ties or behavior that might put the president and his family in legal jeopardy if those things were exposed? The senior Democrat on the banking committee is Senator Sherrod Brown. He says he's seen enough about this particular deal to justify starting a new inquiry into our new president. We'll have more on that ahead. But if there is an independent, truly independent inquiry into this president, whether it starts in Russia and winds its way through Azerbaijan, or whether it maybe even starts here, starts with this in Azerbaijan, there is a reason we should expect this White House, this president, to do everything in his power to keep secret his finances and his business dealings. But you know what? If you get paid an extra $60 million for a house in Palm Beach that no one wants to live in, and it gets torn down with a guy never living in it, never setting foot in it, you get paid an extra $60 million over what you paid for it, and you put nothing into it, and the guy who paid it is a Russian guy? That needs explaining. If your company is getting paid millions of dollars for a project that makes no sense, that is one degree of separation from the Iranian Revolutionary Guard, that needs explaining. We've got two of these stories now in 1 week.
All right. Let me try to follow all that. All right, so Trump is affiliated with Iran. He's affiliated with some kind of business deal in Azerbaijan with some guy who's supposed to be like the Coleons of that particular country, a cartoonish villain of sorts. In addition to just general corruption dealing with real estate in a different country, Rachel Maddow says, if you're acting illegally, you have to know whether or not that particular country or that particular agent is acting illegally within that country because it's against the law. She also made a very strong point about terror, saying that if Trump is laundering money for a terrorist organization, that is also against the law. And look, she's being pretty incisive. She's like drilling into it, trying to get to the bottom, trying to get to the information itself. Here's the problem. It's fine to do that. If you're not going to do that with everybody, though, it looks a little sketchy. So I distinctly remember this interview that Rachel Maddow had with Hillary Clinton. And the question of the Clinton Foundation came up. In the previous one, that particular Rachel Maddow had a lot of questions. She was curious. She was incisive. She wanted to know. She was skeptical. She's cynical. She wanted to get to the bottom of it. Let's see if she handles Hillary the same way.
Last question, which I'm asking in part because we're here in New York, which is the headquarters of the Clinton Foundation and the Clinton Global Initiative. Is there a case to be made, an ethical case to be made, that the Clinton Foundation and the Global Initiative should essentially be wound down as a family foundation while you run for president? I ask that because I think about the good works, the good charitable works that the Clinton Foundation has done. But the way that some of that work gets done is by soliciting donations from people in this country, from people around the world, from organizations around the world. I think it is not unreasonable to suspect that people may give donations to the Clinton Foundation, hoping that they will favorably influence your opinion toward them as a presidential candidate, or eventually as president if you're elected. Is there an ethical concern there that there should be essentially a split between you and your family and this foundation that has done good work, but now you're in a different position with regard to potential donors?
Well, look, I think that the work that it's done has been extraordinary.
Look, that's a decent question. She's essentially, granted, it took her forever to get it out, but hey, you're running to be president of the United States. In addition to being president of the United States, you also function in the government and State Department. Is it a good idea to have these foreign interests giving you money for access? That's the question she's asking. That's a straightforward question.
Extraordinary, and I give the credit to my husband and my daughter because I haven't been involved for that long. And, you know, when I look at what they've accomplished and what they've been able to amplify in terms of saving lives by getting the price of drugs for HIV/AIDS down in sub-Saharan Africa, it's quite astonishing. Mm. And I would hate to lose that creativity, that imagination, that extraordinary flexibility. So I think the answer is transparency. And there is no doubt that there will be complete transparency about donations. But when you have hundreds of thousands of people who are donating, as they do, I think that the best answer for that is what we have been doing for the last several years, and that is to be transparent about it.
Now, again, let's make sure we understand the question. You're trying to be president of the United States. You have plenty of foreign bodies, plenty of business interests giving you money for access. Those people are not giving for their health. They can give to any other charity. They specifically give to your charity. You don't think that's a little weird? Hillary's response was, well, I mean, as long as you're transparent, I don't see an issue here. Now, certainly, the skeptical, cynical person that was in the other interview that wouldn't take, you know, the shallow version of events, she's not going to take this shit off of Hillary Clinton. She didn't take it off Donald Trump. There's no way she's going to let Hillary get away with
it. Let voters and others make their judgment.
Secretary, it's really nice of you to get this time.
It's a pleasure.
Oh. So she did let Hillary get away with that. That's amazing. That's fascinating. Understand what I'm saying? That's fascinating. Anybody who's looked at the Podesta leaks know the Clinton Foundation is a slush fund. Hillary Clinton was taking money from all sorts of governments. There was one situation where she was taking money in the State Department, functioning in the State Department, taking money from Saudi Arabia. Hillary Clinton has letters where she herself is saying Saudi Arabia is a state sponsor of terror. At the exact same time, she's taking money from Saudi Arabia and giving them weapons, approving weapons, to go to that country that she herself considered a state sponsor of terror. That's not the only place. Many of those places will say stuff like, you know, these people are professional. Or they were mad at Chelsea because Chelsea was like, hey, this looks a little illegal. I mean, Chelsea Clinton had this, it was funny. She had this epiphany of like, hey, it looks like we're taking money for favors. This looks a little weird. One of the other guys essentially made this point, yeah, Chelsea needs to shut up. That's essentially what he's saying. I'm paraphrasing, but he was like, unless she wants the information revealed about money being spent on her wedding or something like that, Chelsea needs to keep her mouth shut. It's a slush fund. It's an absolute slush fund. The WikiLeaks document massive corruption in that organization. If they wanted to lock her up, the Clinton Foundation would have been the avenue in which they were going to lock her up. Rachel Maddow gave her a complete pass on all of it. She was literally in the other story talking about, hey, you should know if somebody is a terrorist. You should know if the person is supporting terror organizations around the world. You should know what the behavior of the particular government that you're dealing with is doing. They were giving her pay-for-play favors. They would have a contact with Hillary Clinton. Somebody would send her a letter. One of her own people would say, hey, we need to meet this person because this person is a high donor. Somebody else, if I think it was from like, don't quote me on this, but it was, what was the African nation? The African nation, excuse me, near Spain. But essentially, giving her all of this money for all this access, Bill Clinton was getting like $1 million just as retainers from some of these people who he was working with. I mean, it's a slush fund. She's talking to somebody who's essentially running a slush fund, whose information and evidence is out there that it was a slush fund. The only reason Rachel Maddow asked that question in the first place is because on some level she was aware that, hey, this looks bad. It looks like you're getting paid for play. Hillary Clinton says, yeah, I'm not changing it. I think you know, I just need to be transparent. And she's like, oh, okay, well, hey, that's a great interview. Thank you very much for your time. That's a completely different thing than what she did with Donald Trump when she's going through each and every crevice and she doesn't believe anything that she's dealing with. Hillary Clinton gives her one shallow answer. She takes that answer and goes with it. That's amazing. That's amazing. Where's your integrity with this stuff? Where's your integrity? So what? You're just a shill for the Democratic Party? Then stop pretending you have a news show. That's what it boils down to. Stop pretending you have a news show. You're not giving people news. You're giving people, essentially, propaganda from the Democratic Party. Purely attacking another party while not necessarily saying you're functioning in the capacity of functioning as the Democratic Party. You're just a wing of the party at this point. It's amazing. Absolutely amazing. Be fair in your reporting. You can attack Donald Trump. I'm not having to go at you for attacking Donald Trump. I'm having to go at you for not being fair in the way you're attacking him. There's a difference between those two things. All right, guys. Thank you.